It's fairly informal. We usually just open it to whatever questions you like, or I can always start diving into different categories of intellectual property. But if you've got specific questions, that would be good. The one quick note that I like to make at the beginning is if you've got any type of intellectual property that you think needs to remain private, don't disclose any of the details, because it's attorney-client confidentiality with me, but then with the other people in the room it's not. So if it's more along the lines of copyright or trademark, you're probably okay with any type of invention. Okay. Just maybe give some broad overview instead of the specific details. So do either of you have questions, or did you want me to just jump in?
Well, I do have a couple questions.
Okay.
I can start with a simple one. I started my business a year ago, February,
mm-hmm.
and what I do is I have programs that I've created, skill-based creative programs.
Okay.
That teach kids. I specifically focus on kids and teens. I do a little bit of adults.
Okay.
But I teach them different aspects of fashion, kind of the whole design process of fashion, including sewing, fashion design, illustration, branding.
Okay.
A lot of my programs are geared towards sewing, and I start at 7 years old, and I go all the way through high school, kids
okay.
and teens. One of the programs that I created is a 4-week program.
Okay.
If I wanted to trademark that, or mm-hmm. copyright that, or register that.
Trademark.
What do I need to do that? And is there something that I can do without actually paying a large fee and having it professionally? You know, can I put it out there with a TM next to it or an R without actually having done something?
You can put the TM next to it to indicate that you're preserving your common law trademark rights. The R is reserved for actually registered marks. So you can't use the R without registering it with the Patent and Trademark Office.
Okay.
In terms of the registration, the government has you can file online and file the trademark application that way. That is typically something that we do. I have seen some people file trademark applications and have some success with it, and I've had some people file trademark applications where they didn't quite know what they were doing and they almost got it right, but then they didn't, and then once it's filed you can't change it. So it usually is a little bit better to go through an attorney if you can, but it can be done without the use of an attorney.
And what is the fee usually for something like that?
For the trademark application, the total fee, including the government fee and our legal fee, is right around $800. And then there may be some follow-on fees depending on some certain things, but that usually gets you started.
But I can use the TM.
Yeah, you can use the TM. The downside to not registering that we're seeing with the internet age is that once you're using it, anybody can see that you're using it and they can take it and register the mark around you. So they can start using it, let's say in California, they can file for a trademark application with USPTO. USPTO only searches other federal trademarks.
So Rebecca, if I put it out there on the internet, you know, on my website, and I had a TM next to it, if somebody in California wanted to use that,
they can actually
put an R, they could get it registered, and then I couldn't use it anymore.
Right. Well, you'd be able to use it locally, and the geographic databases, geographic areas that you had already started using it, but they'd be able to prevent you from expanding. And we've seen that in Buffalo, unfortunately, where a business wanted to start expanding and going into different regions, and we ran up against some problems at the trademark office. So that is one of the benefits of the federal trademark registration.
I feel like somebody also told me when I became an LLC that, like, at the bottom of my website or wherever I put Fashion Lab NY, I can put the TM next to it.
Yeah, that's correct.
And what does that do for me? I mean,
it preserves your common law rights. So whatever geographic locations that you're using that mark, you're protected. So if you're using it in Buffalo and then you've got clients in Pittsburgh, let's just say, you'd be able to retain those geographic locations, but you wouldn't necessarily have rights beyond that. That's what the federal registration does. It gives you rights across the entire United States and all of our territories. So.
Is it something that I should do?
You're asking the wrong person, because I'm going to tell you to trademark your marks every day of the week and twice on Tuesdays.
Even if I have an LLC.
Right, the LLC only protects your name locally. The LLC is done through the state of New York, right. So it doesn't
so
give
locally
you,
for the state.
Yeah, because it's not the federal government, so the United States Patent and Trademark Office is where it's done at the federal level. So it's interesting, I love telling the story. I started out as a patent attorney, and John and I were both at Hodgson Russ. John's my business partner, he's not able to be here today. We both started at Hodgson Russ, and we're both patent attorneys, and we need a science background, and so we're thinking, oh, patents are the strongest type of intellectual property. Well, we spun off and we started this law firm, and we started doing a lot of trademark work because we saw that there was a need for that. And as a result of that, what I'm starting to realize is that trademarks are probably stronger than patents. Because they can last forever as long as you continue using them. They identify the source of goods and services. You can keep everybody else away from your branding. If you think of Coca-Cola, they're able to keep the name Coca-Cola until they stop using it. Patents expire. They can be, sometimes you can engineer around the invention, but when there's branding, you can't get too close to it without that brand telling you to back off of their trademark.
So when you create a registered trademark, when you go through the process of doing that, is it a one-time thing, or every year do you need to pay to?
That's a great question. It is mostly a one-off thing, but then you have to come back at the five-year mark and say, we're still using this. And then you come back at the 10-year mark, say we're still using this, and then 20, 30, 40, 50.
Because I remember when I was at that other company,
yeah,
I was having conversations with you because things were coming.
Right, renewals.
Renewals.
Yeah, so you have to renew. You have to renew it, and the reason for that is if you've got a great name and a great brand and you go out of business, then that's blocked off from anybody else being able to use it. So if the business isn't using it anymore, they cancel the trademark registration, and that opens it up for somebody else to be able to use it. So I'm not sure if I can think of an example offhand, but if a pharmaceutical company has a great name for one of their drugs or something, and they go out of business, maybe somebody else would want to use that name for a similar acting medicine or something along those lines. So that's
I'm just going to, if you can pass these and
sure
for you. And maybe my question, I'm a graphic designer, so I'm more from the graphic part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So when she said, she was talking about a name, a written word. So when she trademarks that, does she need to do it like in the written word? And if that written word is going to come up like a logo, or it's going to have like a certain shape? What's the scenario there? Does trademarking the word gives me the legal or the coverage to then put it in a graphic certain type of presentation?
Yeah, this is also a great question. So there's a couple different ways that this can be handled. The word just as text can be covered on its own, and that's very broad. So you can just have, I always use Nike as an example, but Nike just in regular font, and that covers them. If they want to stylize it, it's still the same word, so they're still covered. If you've got something stylized and combined with a logo, that would be a separate trademark. Nike's always my favorite example. You've got Nike, their slogan is just do it, and then their little swoosh. Those are all three separate trademarks. But in some cases around here, I'll see clients, they'll have their name and then their name incorporated in a stylized fashion with a logo, so we'll usually protect that as well. So the graphic design things that you make, those would be all separate trademarks.
And the process is the same?
Yeah.
So the fees are also the same?
Right. Yeah.
How much are the fees for a trademark?
To get you started, the fee is roughly $800, and that includes the government fee.
$800?
Yeah, there may be some follow-on fees later on, but in some cases they're hard to predict. Not that hard to predict, but they're, it depends on a couple different things.
So each one would be, so Nike, the logo, and then the slogan would be 888? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, in their case it would be a little bit more because that the government fee that I'm discussing covers one international class of goods. So for my clients, it's usually just one. So if you've got a coffee shop and you're selling baked goods, that's just going to be one. But Nike, as you can imagine, they've got sneakers, they've got other promotional things. So they spend a ton of money on their trademark portfolio, as you can imagine.
Sure.
Yeah.
And they have to do those every 5, 10, 20 years.
Yeah. So after the first 5 years, you know, because small businesses sometimes they fold within 5 years.
Right.
That's why they do that one. And then you have to come back 5 years later, but then from then on it's just every 10 years.
Yeah.
And those fees are not exorbitant. Mm-hmm.
They're not the $800 again?
No, just a couple hundred dollars.
So it's just a reasonable fee.
Right, pretty much. Sort of like your, probably more expensive than your car.
Right.
What happens, Rebecca, when you like for example, Coca-Cola? Mm-hmm. That's not red. That's Coca-Cola's red.
Right.
What happens, like with color? You have the same logo. Let's say you have the word, mm-hmm. the logo, but there's the color that you also want.
This is also a great question. That is called trade dress, and it's basically the equivalent of a trademark, but it's just color. Anything that identifies the source of goods and services, that is covered by trademark. So if you're driving around the countryside and you see a machine that's green and yellow, mm-hmm. who provided it?
John Deere.
I was thinking.
And then in New York City, if you see somebody walking around with a bag that's golden, that's Robin Egg Blue.
Tiffany.
Right. And if you hear, okay, I'm gonna pretend to sing. Oh my God! Added that out of the video.
AT&T.
It was supposed to be NBC.
Okay.
But yeah, so.
So those things are by the trade dress.
Yeah, they're all covered by trade dress, which is essentially the same thing as trademark.
So another store can come and use the Tiffany blue bag?
No.
Or they couldn't use the Tiffany
not
blue
even logo. Like...
Right, they couldn't use that. Now, if it's a completely unrelated business, they might be able to.
Okay.
So if, let's say, it's auto parts or something, they might be okay.
Right.
But if Tiffany has their Robin Egg blue and their logo and they register that, that covers that logo in that color. I mean, they can't register. I mean,
they can like register
if I was
color.
Making this and my logo was that color, are they gonna sue me? Can they sue me?
No, in that case, it's not the blue that's identifying your source of goods and services, but just the blue on its own is identifying that that's from Tiffany's. Mm-hmm. So you can use that color for different logos. Yeah, completely unrelated.
So how do you find, okay, so say Tiffany's, there's another jewelry store in Idaho that has a Tiffany blue color. How does Tiffany's know that?
They've got people looking for that.
Okay, so that's smaller scale. So smaller scale, how would we know that if someone was using our things? It's not like, if they go to register it, they won't be able to, right? Like that would be
right, they wouldn't be able to. If they're too confusingly similar to your logo or trademark. That's a great question. There are different ways to police it and monitor it. I've had clients who their client base is so reliable that they've contacted, this is a local store I'm thinking of, they've been emailed saying, hey, these folks over in Australia are using your exact logo.
Really?
Yeah.
And they've been able to shut it down?
Okay. Yeah, that was a combination of copyright and trademark law, but we did finally get them to shut it down. And that example, those people were on Facebook, and that almost made it easier because Facebook takes intellectual property.
Yeah,
they take it seriously.
Yes, because like in the other hand, I can have clients that can come to me and say, I like the Tiffany logo, and can you do something that is not that, but it's similar? Like, there's always...
Wasn't there a certain percentage that you have to be different?
Well, the standard is... This part gets a little tricky, but the standard is confusingly similar. So they look at 8 to 10 Polaroid factors under trademark law to determine whether the mark is confusingly similar. So they'll look at the strength of the mark that's being infringed, the goods and services, and some other factors that end up getting sort of confusing. Mm-hmm. But it is a little bit subjective in some cases, and you just have to try to steer clear of that, mm-hmm. and then do an analysis. And in your case, you know, ideally what you could tell the client is that they're going to want to form their own brand and really piggyback off of somebody else.
Yeah.
So when you're starting out, you don't really have much brand recognition, but as time goes on, you do.
So I kind of didn't have like a whole point yet, and now
okay.
I have a point. Now I have an actual, this is my manual that I wrote. This is all my work. So I hand wrote all this. I know to copyright it because you told me at the bottom.
Okay.
But now I don't know where to go from here. So I've created a program with a name that I've created.
Yeah.
I think I need to trademark that.
That needs to be trademarked. That's going to be ripped off because I want to steal that.
Right. and then the logo that they created for me, as long as they give me the copy, assigned a copyright to me.
Copyright doesn't always protect logos. Do you have a copy of your logo?
Yeah, I printed the wrong one. Oh, it's on. I have mine on my phone. But actually, I didn't like the designer, so I hired someone else. So it's still in the works.
Okay.
But
in some cases, copyright will attach to a logo, and sometimes it doesn't.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Copyright attaches to original works
that's,
of
that's what they have.
Authorship.
He hand you those.
That would be copyrighted, so you would need an assignment.
I will. So they're going to write me an assignment.
Yeah, or at least a licensing agreement.
Okay.
But an outright assignment would be better. Copyright covers original works of authorship, so a painting, a poem, a movie, music, not most logos. For example, Nike Swoosh, I don't think that is really anything that interesting, so I don't think that rises to the level of original work of authorship. But our Buckyball, for example, I think does rise to the level of original authorship.
So
it's got to be something original. So it can't just be, you know, like a plus symbol,
right?
Or a little swoosh. It's got to be a little bit more interesting than that.
So then I would need. What did you say? An assignment?
I think an outright assignment would be best.
And what does that mean?
Yes.
So the person that creates the work of authorship holds the rights to the intellectual property. In the case of an artist, you may want to assign the ownership of that copyright to somebody else. So recently in pop culture, we saw that George Lucas assigned his copyrights for Star Wars over to Disney. So they're allowed to make derivative movies based on Star Wars. They're allowed to do all kinds of different characters for Star Wars. Whereas before he actually owned the property. So this is actually important for your work because
mm-hmm.
if they do want to trademark or copyright it, they might want you to assign it outright to them.
Mm-hmm.
And then what the graphic designer would want to do is to hold on to a portion of the rights so that he or she can use the graphic design in their portfolio.
Yes, just to show it. Yes, but because that's whenever even when I present a proposal, those are kind of the first lines that I kind of,
right.
like any of the ideas that I present to you during the process belong to me. But you are entitled to own your logo. I just
right.
ask that for my portfolio, I can show
right.
The final logo. For some reasons, I can show the process, but you don't own the process, and you don't own any of the other ideas.
Right.
So what is it? Is just like a something written, or
it's basically a contract,
mm-hmm.
and you both parties sign it. and they're fairly straightforward, and then you just kind of go from there.
Can you say the proper name of that contract?
In some cases it's a licensing agreement, and in other cases it's an assignment. So it depends on where final ownership of the intellectual property will sit. Mm-hmm. So in your case, it would probably be an assignment outright to the client with you reserving a licensing agreement to use it for purposes of your portfolio.
Mm-hmm. And I guess that is something that you do only with clients that really ask for it, or should that be something that you do with all of the...
Yeah, that should be done with all of the clients, because the old saying that, you know, fences make the best neighbors, right? So mm-hmm. at the outset, you're both on the same page. You own the graphic design, I have rights to put it on my website, and then they come back and say, oh, you don't have the right to this, and you show them the contract. Oh, yeah, okay, that's right, I forgot. Mm-hmm. Right, because you remember everything and everybody's happy until they're not happy. Mm-hmm. And that's when memories start to fade. And
okay.
So, mm-hmm. and that's something that we can put together for you if you don't already have one, and it would be something pretty standard that you would just use all the time with your clients. Just change the names at the top, mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. just hold on to copies of those mm-hmm. for your own records. And clients, for the most part, aren't going to have any issue with signing something like that, because mm-hmm. it protects them too. So they know what they're paying for, and yeah.
Okay. Yes, I think that also gives the whole work more support, you know,
yeah.
in both ways. You yeah. are trusting that person is trusting you, and for some reason that makes also the work more
credible.
Professional.
Yes. Yeah, like it makes me think if you were doing my logo, that I would feel like you're more credible, like
yes.
you want to, in writing, like this is
yes.
legally the way it goes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. I wrote this track, like this is mine. So I don't want, I created this out of my head, like
mm-hmm.
it didn't come from somewhere. So I don't want another trainer who's not trained by me and paying me to teach it to go and teach this and take this. Because obviously if I'm teaching other people, the work's
mm-hmm.
going to get out there.
Right.
What do I do to this to make sure that doesn't happen?
Typically, this is covered through branding, which
okay.
is not as strong as you would hope.
Mm-hmm.
But you can... we've done this with several other clients before, where it's all done through contract. So the person that you're training agrees to certain.
Okay. So.
And I'm sorry to interrupt, but so, what difference does it or it is between that concept branding that you're telling her
mm-hmm.
instead of is she going more into franchising? Franchising?
There's the potential to go into franchising for that, yeah.
Isn't better for her to kind of take that figure instead of the branding, so she can...
Well, the branding is part of franchising.
Oh, okay.
So all McDonald's, I believe, are franchised. So the branding is McDonald's, the Golden Arches,
mm-hmm.
the look and feel of the building,
mm-hmm.
all their trademarks and logos.
Mm-hmm.
And then the franchising is where the main person at McDonald's is licensing out rights to use that branding, and then that person has to follow all the certain, the way they make their food and cash people out and the way the
mm-hmm.
restaurant looks.
Mm-hmm.
So that's it. Franchising and branding are somewhat similar. Franchising is where you're paying to use the brand.
Mm-hmm.
So the branding is everything that comes together to identify the source of goods
mm-hmm.
or services. Did you have another question?
Questions, but I think that from my perspective, being here, being new, I'm not original from here. I come from Guatemala, so my laws were completely different.
Oh yeah.
I'm trying to get to know. That's
yeah.
why it was very important for me here. But more likely, it's regarding like creating brands. You
mm-hmm.
know, I always say to my clients that whatever fee also they pay for me, it doesn't cover like registering or, but
right.
one interesting thing is naming,
mm-hmm.
naming, and maybe that goes back to the original or the first question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you do, or do you have any advice regarding the process of naming?
Picking out a name?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I do. From the trademark standpoint, you want something as, you don't want it to be descriptive, and that's what everybody wants. They want something descriptive, like they want to call their beer delicious beer, or you know, beer like beer, or you know, really something that's just descriptive. Or they want to call their apples apple, and you can't, it can't be completely generic, because then nobody else can call their apples apple, right? So that's not good. So then there can be something that's sort of suggestive, which is what the pharmaceutical company does. I think there's like an antidepressant medicine called Elevil, right? So, you know, elevate your mood, Elevil. So it's suggestive. That's okay. And then you've got something that's just completely unrelated to anything. Apple in connection with computers is...
Nike. I mean, Nike was the goddess of something.
Yeah, the goddess of war, was it?
I honestly don't remember, but I know what it was, and it... they made it into a shoe brand.
Yeah. So, but that connotation is kind of interesting, you know, a very powerful woman getting stuff done, and then, oh, you need these sneakers so you can be that person, right? And then, of course, there are a couple of just completely made up words. The only two I can ever think of are Kodak and Google. They're just completely made up. They never meant anything until they started using those. So those are the best. Around town, I see a couple of places, they'll call their business, you know, 510 Washington Street LLC. I guess that's okay for the LLC, but if that's going to be your actual name, in my opinion, it should be a little bit more interesting. There are some businesses, I'm not going to name any names, but you can see that they put a lot of thought into the location. They've got design and decoration. They've got great products in their name in there, and then they just come up with this really generic name. Mm-hmm. And it just, to me, as somebody that started my own business, it seems very uninspired. Mm-hmm. The average person probably wouldn't notice that, but so there's two answers to your question. One is thinking about it from a trademark standpoint, where you just don't want it to be completely generic or descriptive. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then what appeals and has cachet to the consuming public.
When you put a little R registered next to something, because obviously copyright, you said in the last meeting, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, that I can copyright this page by putting copyright on the bottom.
You can put a circle C. You can't use the circle R unless you're registered.
And that's registered trademark.
Right, through the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office.
So what's the circle C versus circle TM? Or there is no circle?
A circle C is for copyright.
Copyright. Okay.
And then the TM is trademark. So they're different categories. A service mark, it just means that you're preserving your common law rights, which means you've got rights to it in the geographic area that you're already using it. So the benefit to the federal trademark registration is that you get nationwide and United States territories protection. So nobody can use it.
So when I design something, and let's say for me, that's two different things, but when I design a logo and then we have a tagline, for example, so in my design, I can include next to the logo, just like also to educate my clients and keep this go to the next step for them. I can add the TM.
You could. It's not necessary, but you could.
But let's just say, just to at least to explain them, or if they are wondering more about making the brand like a trademark registered mark. But if we have a tagline, or if we have, like, that happens sometimes with jingles or like you say, like poems or those sort of things, that should be the C.
For a poem, a jingle might be a trademark and it might be a copyright.